Imagine that I'm a fruit fly. A lot of my daily routine is based on instinctively reacting to stimuli in my environment. If I smell something yummy that could be food, I'll exhibit positive chemotaxis, or movement toward a chemical stimulus. If I smell something nasty that could be bad for me, I'll exhibit negative chemotaxis, or movement away from a chemical stimulus. I totally rely on these behaviors to survive and thrive in the world. And it turns out that we don't have to rely on our imaginations and on my bad acting to understand this phenomenon. We can observe and test it in the lab using real fruit flies, aka Drosophila melanogaster. Drosophila is a star in the scientific research community. It's so well studied that it's known as a model organism. It's teeny tiny and not picky about where it lives, so it's super easy to raise in a laboratory. It doesn't take long to go from egg to an adult fly, and it can be easily manipulated in behavioral and genetic experiments. So it's pretty exciting that we get to work with these little superstars today. I feel like I'm meeting a celebrity. I'll walk you through how to set up an experiment that will test chemotaxis behaviors in fruit flies, and then leave you to design your own experiment to select which chemical stimuli to test. You'll need fruit flies, about 40 per experiment. You can order them from most biological supply companies. 2 matching clear plastic water bottles. They should be dry and have their labels removed. Extra water bottle caps. A box cutter, clear packing tape and a permanent marker, a small funnel, cotton balls and scotch tape, white paper, distilled water, various chemical stimuli of your choosing. I've got a fun selection of various foods and cleaning supplies, droppers, one for each stimulus that you're testing, and a timer. One super important thing about working with fruit flies in the lab is that we do not want them to escape. They're bred by laboratory supply facilities and don't represent the gene pool of fruit flies found in nature, so they really shouldn't mix. We're going to make every effort not to let our flies get out. And we also just wouldn't be able to run our experiment today if our flies were going all over the place. So we're going to construct an apparatus out of water bottles called a choice chamber that will contain the flies and allow us to repeat our experiments using different stimuli. First, I'll cut the bottoms off my water bottles. Then I'll tape the bottles together with their cutoff bottoms facing each other and the caps at opposite ends. I'll label one bottle A and the other bottle B with my permanent marker. Next, I'll make a little loop out of scotch tape and stick it inside one cap and do the same on the other cap. I'll press my cotton balls into the caps so that they stick to the tape. Now I'm ready to add my stimuli. Don't get too excited though. The first thing we'll need to do is collect control data using distilled water. I'm going to add a few drops of distilled water to each cotton ball, but you do not want to soak the cotton balls. You can actually drown your flies if there's too much moisture in there. I'll put a cap back on one bottle, and then I've got to transfer my flies from the culture vial they came in to the choice chamber. In the lab, you can often anesthetize your flies to move them, but we can't do that with behavioral experiments because sleepy flies won't behave normally. Instead, I'll put my funnel in the open bottle, then tap the vial of flies so they all fall to the bottom. I'll quickly uncap the vial, flip it over onto the funnel, and tap again so that the flies fall from the vial through the funnel and into the choice chamber. I'll quickly put the second cap on the open end of the choice chamber so the flies don't escape. I'll lay the chamber on a white piece of paper. This makes it easy to see the flies and gives a uniform background in case color is a stimulus, and then I'll set my timer for 5 minutes. While I run the experiment, I am going to be a very calming presence to my fruit flies. I'm not going to scream or stomp around or push my chair back super hard from the table. We do not want to become a stimulus to them. We just want to sit back and relax and let them wander around the choice chamber undisturbed. At the end of 5 minutes, I'm going to write down how many flies are inside A of the chamber. Looks like I've got 33 flies over there. And how many flies are inside B? Looks like I've got 27 flies on side B. Oops, that's 60 flies in total instead of 40, but that's okay. If there are any flies smack in the middle, I won't count them. But it looks like all my flies picked a side, so I'm all good. Remember, that was our control data because both sides contained distilled water. Now we want to see if the flies exhibit chemotaxis when exposed to a household substance. We'll do all of our experimental data collection in comparison to distilled water. So we'll keep the distilled water cap on side B and swap out side A for various chemical stimuli. When choosing the substances you want to test, you should think about where you've observed fruit flies hanging out before. What might be attracting them and what might keep them away? I'm going to try some mustard because I've definitely seen fruit flies get way too interested in my picnic sandwiches. But remember, we cannot eat the test substances. The second they enter the lab, they become off limits. As tempting as a snack may be after a long afternoon of sciencing, I'm going to add a few drops of mustard to a fresh cotton ball stuck to a fresh cap. Then I'll tap the flies down again in the chamber and quickly swap out my distilled water cap on side A for a new mustard cap. Again, I'll wait 5 minutes for the flies to make their choice and then record my test substance and the number of flies in side A and B. This time, I have 52 flies on mustard side A and 8 on distilled water side B. Before I analyze my data, I have one final step left. Once I'm sure I've done all of the choice experiments I want, and my flies have lived their best life trying out different substances, I have to give them the best death possible. As I said before, we can't set them free to mingle with naturally occurring fruit fly populations, so the most humane thing to do now is to end their life swiftly and painlessly. The standard way to do this in the lab is with a fly morgue, which is just a beaker of soapy water with a funnel. I'll tap my flies from the chamber into the morgue and give it a swirl, thanking them for their science service as I do. Okay, let's take our mind off the fly morgue with some data analysis. My data seem to indicate that my flies showed positive chemotaxis toward the mustard side, but how can I be confident that these numbers reflect a legitimate trend and aren't just due to chance? Time to do some math. I'm going to perform a chi-squared analysis, which will test whether there is a statistically significant difference between an expected and observed outcome. In this experiment, the expected outcome is what would happen if the flies weren't exhibiting any chemotaxis. In other words, we would expect to have an equal number of flies in side A and side B. Since I was working with 60 flies total, the expected outcome without chemotaxis would be 30 flies on each side. The chi-squared analysis tests a null hypothesis that there is no statistically significant difference between the expected outcome and the observed outcome in our experiment. Remember that the observed outcome was 52 flies on side A and 8 flies on side B. The formula for the test is chi-squared equals the sum of the observed outcome minus the expected outcome squared, then divided by the expected outcome. We have two outcomes, side A and side B. So the formula with our experiment would be chi squared equals side A observed minus side A expected squared, then divided by side A expected, plus side B observed minus side B expected squared, then divided by side B expected. And with our actual data, that's chi squared equals 52 minus 30 squared, then divided by 30, plus 8 minus 30 squared, then divided by 30. Okay, my chi squared value is 32.267. But what does this mean? To find out, we need to determine two values. The first is the degrees of freedom in our experiment, which is just the number of outcomes minus 1. We had two outcomes, A and B, so there was 1 degree of freedom in our experiment. The second is how confident we want to be in our determination of statistical significance. We'll choose the commonly used p-value of 0.05, meaning we're 95% certain that our results are legit and not due to random chance. Once we have those two numbers in hand, we can consult our handy-dandy critical values chart, which is a standardized list of chi-square values that are needed to reject the null hypothesis for a given degree of freedom and confidence level. From the chart, I can see that for 1 degree of freedom, I need a chi-squared value of at least 3.841 in order for me to be 95% certain that my data rejects the null hypothesis. My chi-squared value is 32.267, which is definitely higher than 3.841. Hooray! That means I can reject the null hypothesis that my flies weren't exhibiting any chemotaxis. In other words, they were exhibiting statistically significant movement toward the chemical stimulus of mustard. I'm so proud of them. RIP. I'll also want to run chi-squared tests on my control data, as well as any results from additional choice experiments using different substances. For your control data, your expected outcome is still half the flies in each side of the chamber, and your observed outcome is what you actually saw in your own control experiment. Your control data is valid if your chi-squared result is below the critical value of 3.841, meaning there wasn't a significant difference between your observed and expected outcomes, and your flies weren't exhibiting any chemotaxis. Now that you know how to set up a choice chamber and handle fruit flies in the lab, it's time for you to go off and design your own chemotaxis experiments. Have fun deciding which household substances you'd like to test based on your own observations of fruit fly behavior in the wild. And remember, no eating the lab mustard!